get off this thing.
Where's Marcus?
Well, hello again. It's me, and it's Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade with the part three of Belly of the Steel Beast. So this is just the last section, really, 11M3 over the cliff. Orchestration-wise, it's pretty much the same as the previous two cues. They all run into each other. and thematically, this is the Brutal Bolero that Frank Lehman has called it. In his catalogue. It's very similar to a sort of Alex North style scoring, sort of thinking of things like Spartacus, for example. It's very brass heavy, very wind heavy as well, actually. There's a huge amount of very high wind, which is sort of, you know, anathema to most composition these days in the 2020s. We tend not to sort of have huge piccolo things going on all the time. So there's a lot of that going on. and as you can see, it's quite busy as well. There's lots of sort of slightly intricate interlocking parts. For example, here, where we've got little horns who are just doing another tuplet. And then everybody takes over with this da-da-da-da in fifths as well. So there's a sort of, it's interesting from the point of view that it's very thick textured. And then we get a really extraordinary passage here of sort of counterpoint in two different keys as well. Of course it would be two different keys. It's John Williams. What do you expect? and then loads of these sort of 3-3 type chords. 3-3 chords, I generally tend to go for they're the sort of B type rather than a sort of semitone type, by which I mean it's like a sort of major minor thing. So for example, in this set calculator, I might have middle C, then E flat, and then E natural. So it's like a sort of minor dyad and a major dyad on top of each other, but it reduces to 0-1-4 like that as well. But it's just that John Williams's type tends to be 0-3-4, which is the sort of B type, but it's exactly the same. So you can sort of see both types here, 3-3-A, 0-1-4, 3-3-B, 0-3-4, but they've got the same interval content. So one minor second, no major seconds, one minor third, one major third. That's basically what it is. So he uses that extensively, and it kind of gets more and more used as the cue continues, because of course the tension is mounting. So he's using it in that way. And then we've got some really weird oblique sort of chords towards the end as well, which we'll have a look at. So hopefully you sort of short but sweet this one. So so we can see that a lot of it is this sort of bolero setup, by which I mean the rhythm of it. Nothing like Ravel's at all. And we got this sort of tonic dominant type sort of bass line, which is pretty extensive. It sort of goes most of the way through. Like that. And even when it changes key, when it goes up into the semitonal shift, it also does the same sort of thing. Slightly changed rhythmically. And then right at the very end, by the time it gets to the D section, it's even more slightly changed rhythmically. towards the end, there's a sort of hint of Imperial March there, isn't there? It's that sort of, you know, minor third sort of thing going on. But really, that's the main sort of thing. And then all of the sort of innards, all of the sort of harmony innards is just this. And of course, with the trumpets as well, we get, you know, quite an extensive bit of this as well. And it's interesting, note that the orchestration changes as soon as we have a melody, which is now violins, E-flat, clarinet, and the upper wind, which is mainly flutes, piccolo, oboe, that sort of thing. Because we have that going on, I can't isolate just the... I might be able to isolate that. Let's see if it plays just that. No. But we have this melody here. Sorry. You know, a sort of really extraordinary sort of melody, which is all sort of very twiddly, basically. Yes. So, let's go back. Let's put a keyboard up just in case we need it. So mainly, sort of, you know, harmonically A minor, and then it sort of goes like that. And then sometimes coincidental, I would say, harmonic stuff. Because, of course, it's just a dyad here. But, of course, as soon as you put the tune, it becomes like an E-flat minor. And we've got those sort of little discordant bits, which are, again, coincidental. I don't think he's thinking too much about that. In terms of sort of how it fits in, but it does fit in pretty well, and in a sense it's a mixture of harmonic minor and melodic minor, so that's why you get all of the F sharps as well as F naturals as and when they appear a bit later on. So as soon as the setup is done, you'll notice that all the percussion drops out because this is where we have the tune, which is quite prominent, I think, in the recording. And that's the bit where it's, how does one get off this thing, Marcus says. And then, of course, he just gets pushed off. Exactly the same material, just with some melody, so sort of melody dominated homophony at that point. Notice all of these are sort of block chordal functions, and you know, the register as well. By the way, I put all the tubas and stuff like that, bass trombones, just doing the bass line, so it's quite blended, this type of orchestration. You'll see that the violins are basically having the same role as the horns, just slightly different in terms of their register, so they cut through a little bit. And then when it goes from C to E flat, they're kind of just doing the same thing as well. For ease of sort of voicing, basically. So, and the other reason why I've sort of said something about Alex North is that, you know, those open fifths, you know, it was sort of quite a common sort of thing that he would often do as well. So that continues, really. And the next sort of interesting bit is when it goes into a semitonal shift with absolutely no preparation at all. So this transition is just simply going from A to B flat. With the only real proviso, the fact that you've got this sort of timpani hits, which just go up a beat. There's a sort of slight Ben Hur moment of ramming speed, you know, this sort of thing, where it sort of just gets quicker. But we've got the harp, which is sort of leading up to that B flat as well. So that's another thing that helps. Otherwise, there's no real preparation for it at all. When we go into the B flat section, this is exactly the same material as the one that we had at bar 1, 2, 6. So it's exactly here, like that. But now it's just up a semitone. And slightly changed, slightly modified. So then what else is going on? And the interesting thing is that although here the horns are sort of less busy than they were, but the trumpets really have another tune, and they're doing something completely different. So if we imagine that sound, and then above that, we've got... I just wanted to have that on its own. So very discordant. Yeah, so it's really sort of in contrast. So we've got this sort of B flat minor and this sort of sharp four idea, or you could call it flat five as well. So it's sort of octatonic. It takes on a sort of octatonic character without actually being overtly octatonic. You know, if you think about a minor scale, you know, if I just start on the seventh note of the scale, 7, 1, 2, 3, in terms of scale degrees, it's going to sound a little octatonic. So that's how often he sort of not quite conflates, but how he perhaps hints at something which is octatonic when it's not quite. So all of these chords are not particularly octatonic derived. They're sort of standalone chords which work in a minor key. You know, that sort of, I always think of, is it Wonder Woman all? That sort of thing, maybe, I can't remember, but B flat minor with a sharp four. So we know that that works because he uses that all the time. You'll hear it all over A New Hope, for example, in where the Jawas turn up right at the beginning. So we've got those, and then also sort of, you know, bits where he climbs up like that. You know, he can sort of keep going. So they have, again, sort of inadvertent harmony, which sort of appears out of nowhere. So this bit here is mainly that, B-flat minor with a sharp 4. The next bar is because of that F-sharp. It's now B-flat minor with a flat 6, I think, really. We could sort of say it's that, but it's not, because we've got B-flat there. I mean, you do kind of have that in the bass, but really it's a B-flat ostinato. Like that, and then sort of adding extra notes on the top of that, sort of major seventh, is not going to hurt that. It just intensifies the harmony even more. And that's really what this cue is about. It's a further intensification, a further ramping up every sort of few bars or so. So then we've got an interesting one where he does exactly that. So B flat minor, and then sort of a couple of extra notes, it becomes like a sort of 521. And then we get a sort of really weird, rather ambiguous dyad. But because it's sort of already established that it's B minor, it doesn't feel that ambiguous. So if I play all of it just on piano, really, our ear is so used to having B flat minor by that stage, we don't need to hear the D flat. And it's kind of there in the sense that we've got it there, like this. But there's a lot of discordant stuff happening at the same time. But because of what we've heard before, it doesn't feel out of place because we're cemented, as it were, in B flat. So the rest of the scaffolding can be whatever it wants to be, because as soon as you do that, you know, I can put any notes over the top of it and it's still going to be... I mean, literally just random notes, still going to feel B flat minor-ish. Doesn't matter what you put over the top of it. So then we get sort of interesting little bits of 3-3 already coming in here. So remember, that was the sort of thing that I was talking about right at the beginning, that sort of major minor sort of idea, that sort of, those sorts of things. In Mark Richards' course, he just says the voicing is 0-8-11. Which it often is. Here it's slightly different because we've got sort of, you know, here D flat, then middle C, that sort of thing there. But it's the same thing. In this case, it's 3-3-A version, where we have a major third and a minor third, but a semitone above the root note. That is that, and all of those notes are pretty much the same thing. So if I go from here, yeah, so it sounds very discordant, but they're all sort of, you know, the sort of so-called atonal chords, but actually they're just major minor things, really. And then it gets even more crazy with this idea. All of the same, they're all 3-3s, and they're all planed. So once you've got that sort of hand position, so that's the F sharp there, you can vaguely see on the keyboard, and then I'll sort of minor third at the top, like that. You can sort of go around the keyboard doing the same thing, planing or even just sort of transposing. And it sounds atonal, but actually it's just the same chord type which is used. Does that make it atonal? Not really. It's post-tonal in the sense that it's still using tonality in interesting ways without resorting to random atonal elements. Or even serial atonal elements, which he doesn't tend to do that much at all. So then we are on to a tertial shift from D, because we've sort of, from B flat, and then we transition into D. And again, it's not much preparation. You know, that could have been anything here. Could go to A. We could easily do that, but he hasn't gone to A, he's gone to D. And that's where we get the sort of tertial shift. So again, there's not much preparation for the ear, but it still makes sense simply because it just exists there and there's no attempt to do anything about it. I suppose you could argue that that's a leading note, but it doesn't sound like a leading note. But it does make sense in terms of, you know, voice leading as well. And even sort of F, but I can't see any Fs until later there. D5, then we were sort of in B flat minor. And then Interesting, isn't it, that you know, you rarely hear a major seventh chord sound so unlike a major seventh chord when it's surrounded by those minor chords. So we've got B flat minor, and then we got that, which is interesting, and fully root position as well. So A, so A major, and then there. So almost, it behaves, you know, the major seventh actually behaves like a dominant seventh, which is really interesting, you know. Instead of that. So it's interesting how he sort of uses these interesting sort of substitute elements in order to be sort of consistent with what he's got. Because, you know, we've got these fourths going on, and they've existed all the way through from right at the beginning. So it's very... You know, he's so good at sort of linking things motivically. So we then keep in D, and it sort of shifts a little bit because does that make it D or B flat? I don't know. It still feels D, but we then got more of these sort of other elements in the inner parts. So we've got, you know, those here, but then. So it's sort of F sharp add 9. And then going to A7 but without the third. And then back to D. So it's a really interesting harmony. Still feels D because of the melody. And this just now just sounds smudged. So it's interesting that he should use, because I think most people would have just, instead of done that, they would have used an F sharp and not bothered smudging. But it's interesting. It gives you that really interesting sort of smudging effect. So that rubs against that, and then that rubs against that. Really weird. It's a really strange sort of idea of harmony. I wonder whether he's on the piano and sort of goes, you know, did that and sort of thought, oh, I like that. So sometimes there's little explanation for the fact, just, you know, it just makes it a bit different and a bit more tense. Also with all the glissandi, you know, there's a sort of discrepancy of pitch anyway, because, you know, it's never going to be absolutely exact. So then we're on to these other unusual sort of types of chords. So here it sounds like a sort of major seventh, but we don't have that or that or even that, so it's a little bit ambiguous. It kind of feels like that, really, B flat minor, but then we still got D to account to. It's sort of a mixture of major and minor. Typical sort of, you know, mucking around with that major minor feel, which he likes to do. And then it feels a little bit more like, you know, this sort of, like that as well, with a ninth. So from here. With these sort of hammered. That, but still, that's very John Williams-y. So a little bit like a B flat minor, but then also having that major third as well. So it's a sort of alpha chord with a sharp four as well. So alpha chord is a major minor chord, but with a sharp four. So it's called sort of a mixture of all of those things, but because, again, he uses that all the time, it sounds fine. But it's not, at this point, connected to octatonic, hexatonic, Hungarian minor. It's really just a standalone chord that is intensifying just a minor tonality rather than anything else more exotic. So then we've got things happening as well. where right at the end it sort of goes into a chord progression where we got sort of C5 really, well, D actually, and then sort of A aug 9, like that with a flat 9, like that. So it's a sort of little sort of lots of 2 5s or 5 1s, that sort of thing. And then cadencing on D. Don't forget also that, you know, the rate of chord change quickens to the cadence, which is a very classical thing to do. You know, quickening the rate of chord change, or speeding it up, really. So you have changes of chords quicker. Yes, and still you get these little rubs as well. I should probably just put that, that's D, actually, at that point. Let's just go D5, want of anything better. That's actually supposed to be attached to that. But again, because we've got, it still feels D. You know, it feels like sort of D minor and then a big sort of dominant chord going there. And interesting that we sort of end up with a sort of a little bit of that C sharp like that. So it's something, it's not quite all there. Indy's just seemingly fallen off the cliff. And Sulla is very worried, and of course everybody else is. So there is that as well. So that's short and sweet, really. I'm glad I broke it down into three parts, because it was just too much to do in one go. And also you then sort of think, well, maybe I've skirted over things which I didn't want to. So that's the reason I've done it that way with this particular one. And then what I'm really looking forward to is starting A New Hope. So I'm doing a little bit of preparation for that to start off with. And one of the things that cropped up was a timp part, which goes down sort of scalically, which I'm sort of trying to work out, has somebody done? So I think it could be John Williams's brother. Who might have been playing, or at least has played that piece. So I'm going to do a little bit of digging and come back to you on that one. But basically, I'm going to try and reconstruct the original theme from with the resources that he did have, which is 3 flutes, 2 oboes, 3 clarinets, 3 bassoons, 6 horns, 4 trumpets, 3 trombones, bass trombone, tuba, 2 harps, 2 keyboards, and a full set of strings. So I'm going to try and recreate it, because of course, you know, everything we hear is an arrangement of the original. We don't hear it live, and it's quite rare to hear. And the concert version, again, is just an arrangement. It usually uses 3 trumpets, not 4. Okay, admittedly, the first trumpet is usually, the fourth trumpet is usually the same as the first, an octave lower. So it's not missing a huge amount there, but you do kind of miss a little bit. Oh, by the way, 2 tubas is another thing. So I'll come back to you on that one. But when I'm doing that, I will also have a look at some other cues as well, so don't worry too much if that's not quite your thing. So that's it for now, and I'll see you soon.